Shalom, Chabrim. I'm Stephen Ben-Nun. You're watching Israeli News Live. Things happening all over the globe right now, but more specifically, we're going to focus with Syria and with North Korea. Three different subjects we're going to be trying to look at this morning. Syria has been struck by Israeli forces on multiple occasions. Early this morning, reports are coming out about that. Also, North Korea has met with South Korea, calling South Korea their brothers, and that they're not looking for a conflict with South Korea. But nuclear weapons are all faced towards the United States. As well as that, we also have a report coming out that the Christian community inside of Damascus has been directly targeted from a no-conflict zone. All these issues here we're going to go into right now this morning as we gear up here. The Syrian Arab Army is claiming that Israel has attacked them directly, although Prime Minister Netanyahu is saying that Israel was targeting a weapons depot inside of or near Damascus there, where he is concerned about Iranian buildup of forces near its border, as well as Hezbollah getting these advanced weapons into their country via through Syria. But as we can see here, according to the map that we have here on the background right here, these are some of the areas the Israeli military from Lebanon striking up around Jamaria, also Al-Kutaifa, as well as ground surface-to-ground missiles there being fired as well. And all around the areas of Damascus, both north and south of Damascus. So, is this all of these weapons depot areas? I'm not really sure as far as that goes there, but the Syrian military is claiming that Israel is striking them because they're making headway in their battle against those terrorist groups that are fighting against President Bashar al-Assad in Idlib and other places closer to the western part of the country that they're trying to free up. And the Syrian army is saying that Israel is actually trying to slow the Syrian army's gains in this part of the region. Well, Debka here on their file here, they actually bring out some very interesting points. And that is because Washington and other groups are going to be meeting about the dividing up of Syria after the war here, and Israel has been left out of those talks there. It seems that Israel is trying to send a message that they're going to have part of those talks, whether the rest of the nations like it or not. It says right here, Washington sources revealed that deliberations in the White House are to be led by high officials of the U.S. government branches involved in the Syrian policy. Invited to are senior European diplomats from Britain, Germany, France, and Italy, and representatives from Asia led by Japan and India. The conference has been called to hammer out unified U.S. European Asian policy for determining the shape of the regime in post-war Syria, Assad's future role. The Trump administration intends to come out of these deliberations with broadly based U.S.-led coalition policy for Syria that will change Vladimir Putin's plans for leading Syria from a war to peace in conjunction with Iran and Turkey. Now, I have to warn you just a little bit here, especially that for President Putin there. Turkey is not on your side. You might think you've worked out a deal with Iran and Turkey over Syria, but I can tell you right now, Iran is not on your side. We'll go into that in just a moment as well. But the thing is, though, it also shows us that since the whole dividing of the Middle East after the fall of the Ottoman Empire, that this whole issue of Britain and France that were dividing the land, they're still heavily involved, and they're not going to go away peacefully. They're saying that they're determining President Assad's future there, who is supposed to be a sovereign leader, a sovereign president over the country of Syria. Well, more and more, it looks like that the world doesn't seem to recognize the sovereignty of Syria. Very sad to say that indeed, but also sharing with you another issue that is happening inside of Damascus this morning, and this is being reported on RIA.ru. The title here, speaking in Russian here, about targeting the Christian community right in the center of Damascus. Now, they're claiming that this was done by a mortar shell. All right, that's what the reports are saying, but there's no way that a mortar shell caused that much destruction destruction right there in the center of Damascus. And specifically, they're claiming that the violation came from a no-conflict zone on the far eastern side of Damascus, and that it was targeting the Christian community inside of Damascus. You know, you cannot help but remember, as I've said to you, the prophecy of Isaiah chapter 17, the burden of Damascus. Behold, Damascus is taken away from being a city and shall be a ruinous heap. The cities of Aurora are forsaken. They shall be for flocks which shall lie down, and none shall make them afraid. Now here it is. The fortress also shall cease from Ephraim, and the kingdom from Damascus, and the remnant of Aram shall be as the glory of the children of Israel, saith the Lord of hosts. Ephraim. Why is Ephraim mentioned? Why is the fortress for Ephraim coming to an end? Ephraim, friends, is the house of Israel, the remnants of the Ephraim, the Ephraimites, the children of Israel, those first believers of Yeshua's ministry, where the first churches were set up in Damascus. That fortress, President Bashar al-Assad, is going to be toppled. It's not my desire to see that happen, by no means, because clearly the prophet Isaiah knew that there would be a leader in Syria that would be a fortress for the Christian community living in Syria, Damascus. And now, what are we seeing? We're seeing that those Christians are being targeted by militant groups. This is why I'm against the fact that we as Americans are backing these militant groups, or even Israel, either one, giving support to Al-Qaeda or Al-Nusra. These groups here, what do? They're all about jihadism. All they are there for is to bring about oppression. They do not care for the Christian community living in Syria, and they will kill anybody and bring any kind of law, Sharia law, you name it, and oppress the people of Syria in ways unimaginable. Very much like Iran has done since the revolution of 1979. When the women were more free, the Jewish people could live in Iran without oppression. But after the revolution in 1979, and it became a hardline religious Shiite minority, majority there, running the nation, everybody went under a forced religious rule. And that's what they're trying to do with Syria. Why then would Israel want to back something like this when clearly the prophecy of Isaiah says for us not to do it, that we shouldn't be involved in it? You don't believe that? Go down into Isaiah and look at what he says here. All right? Let's find here. All right? Verse 9, "In that day shall his strong cities be as the forsaken places which were forsaken from the children of Israel. As the manner of woods and lofty forests, it shall be a desolation, for thou hast forgotten the God of thy salvation." All right? Who did? The children of Israel. Not only the children of Israel, I'm talking about all the children of Israel. I'm talking about American Christians who are descendants of the house of Israel. I'm talking about Jewish people living in the land of Israel today, the house of Judah, claiming to believe the God of Abraham. "You have forgotten," he says here, "thou hast not been mindful of the rock of thy stronghold," or the rock of thy salvation. You forgot all about him. "Therefore thou didst plant plants of pleasantness, and didst set with slips of a stranger." This is an adulterous act of planting seeds of discrepancy, is what it's speaking about. "And in the day of thy planting thou didst make it grow, and in thy mourning thou didst make thy seed to blossom, a heap of boughs in the days of grief and desperate pain." The prophet Isaiah recognizes that we have forsaken the God of Israel. "As for the believers of Yeshua, you have forsaken your rock." Christ is that rock that Moses Moses stood there and had the elders of Israel go out there and he says, "Smite the rock." Now, second time, it was "speak to the rock." So don't get them confused there. But the elders of Israel go out there and they bring judgment against for the rock there. And Christ was that rock, showing that prophecy that Israel would actually be a judge against Yeshua and would... I won't go there right now, friends. Anyway, the whole point is, as an adulterous act, we have created the problem in Syria, and God is condemning us for allowing it to happen. and you create the problem that causes Damascus to fall, and your brethren, the Ephraimites, the Christians that are there, don't you know they're part of the remnants of the house of Israel? And you allow them to be murdered. It's exactly what's happening. Russia's showing it. It's not even made mainstream media yet. Damascus is attacked. January the 9th, right there, 2018, Damascus, in the heart of Damascus, the Christian community comes under attack. You know, I can understand if Israel truly is trying to stop Hezbollah from getting weapons into their country that they would use against the Israeli population. I could understand that. But we're claiming we're targeting an ammunition depot. Well, we must be targeting a whole bunch of them because we're hitting areas all over the place. Or are we really working with these thugs? The Bible says we are. All right, the Bible clearly tells us, Isaiah says we are. Like it or not, we will be the cause and help of the fall of Damascus. All right, now, let's move on as well. I wanted to bring this up real quick from South Front. This is something we already know about. Photos allegedly showed damage caused to the Russian aircraft at the Khamim Air Base from the militant shelling. I got new information this morning from a friend of mine in Syria that has let me know, because I've been trying to find out who is this militant group that has attacked the Russian air base. It is a Turkish militant group, and the weapons that are being supplied to that Turkish militant group are coming directly from Turkey, from Erdogan himself. And you think, President Putin, that Turkey is all one with you? He's not. He never was. It was a co-conspiracy between President Barack Hussein and Obama and that of President Erdogan to fake the coup to make it look like that they were being targeted by a U.S.-backed coup when it never was a U.S. Well, it was definitely a U.S.-backed operation with Erdogan to make it appear as if it were a coup, so that they could get the Turkish military inside of Syria, so when they get ready to divide the country up in the future, or when they get ready to take down Damascus, they have their men in place. And now we're getting the evidence coming out of Syria, directly from Syria, that it is a Turkish-backed militant group that is striking the Russian military there inside Khamim, the military base there. That's interesting, isn't it? No, Russia's going to be find themselves all by themselves out there, except for maybe China. Russia's totally being isolated by the entire world. And when they think they have friends, they don't have friends. All right, let's move over to North Korea real quick. This was interesting right here. Reuters brings out this article here today about the meeting with South Korea. North Korea tells South Korea it will not discuss nuclear arms in the future talks. Says North Korea said after its first talks with South Korea in more than 2 years that it would not discuss its nuclear weapons with Seoul because they were aimed only at the United States, not its brethren in South Korea. Quote unquote. In a joint statement after 11 hours of talks, pledged to send a large delegation to next month's Pyeongchang Winter Olympics in South Korea, but made a strong complaint after Seoul proposed talks to denuclearize the Korean Peninsula. Officials from both sides said they agreed to meet again to resolve problems, avert accidental conflict, and high tensions over North Korea's program to develop nuclear missiles capable of hitting the United States, but Pyongyang said disarmament would not be part of the discussions. All our weapons, including the atomic bombs, hydrogen bombs, and ballistic missiles, are all only aimed at the United States, not our brethren, nor China and Russia, Pyongyang chief negotiator Ri Sun-won said. They must know then that China and Russia is there to defend them. Don't think that North Korea doesn't know who's on his side. Kim Jong-un does know who's on his side. This is why these rumors, as we reported yesterday, rumors of wars Yeshua spoke about, and Daniel says tidings out of the east and out of the north will greatly trouble him. Don't think that that king of the North doesn't know now that China and Russia have the back of North Korea. If North Korea says these weapons are not pointed in either of those directions, only at the U.S., then the U.S. is their only target. Now, the big issue is, will President Trump back off and try to negotiate so that we don't end up in a nuclear war? Or will the deep state force him to make a preemptive strike that will draw us into a direct conflict with Russia? But you know where Russia is going to take the hardest hit? They're going to take the hardest hit from Turkey. Because Russia will not be expecting that Turkey is their enemy. I'm Stephen Bannoun. You're watching Israeli News Live. Shalom.